All right, sun shining, lawnmowers in the background, that can only mean it's summer. What better time for a summary? Let's do the last two contentions with respect to tractive effort to round it up to the promised number 20. All right, let's get into it. Locomotive personnel back in the 19th century were practical people. They had developed their own beliefs about what made a locomotive work effectively, whether it be firebox volume, heating surface, length of the cylinder stroke, cylinder bore, steam storage, whatever. They had developed these beliefs through empirical study, and by the 1880s, locomotive design had reached a steady and predictable state. Those locomotive personnel appreciated that locomotives were 800 meter runners, 1500 meter runners, half marathon, full marathon. They appreciated that the locomotives needed to have inherent virtues in order to complete their tasks. And they knew full well that tractive effort did not necessarily equate to a locomotive's potency. And here's a worked example. On your left-hand side, we have the UC class from 1901. It's a 460, what I call a T-cow type, what you would call a 10-wheeler. Also introduced in 1901, on your right-hand side is the UC class. It is a 462 wheel arrangement, what I call a Passchendaele, what you call a Pacific. Both introduced in the same year, both had the same boiler pressure, the same driver height, the same cylinder bore, the same cylinder stroke. They therefore developed the same tractive effort. Yet the Q class is a significantly more potent locomotive than the UC, because you can have all the tractive effort in the world you want, but if you are not producing steam, the wheels are not going to turn. Advertising blurbs from the locomotive manufacturers back in the last few decades of the 19th century didn't particularly quote tractive effort. They quoted the general parameters of the locomotive, and routinely they would include a blurb that stated that this particular locomotive, when used by a given railroad, hauled X number of tons up Y grade at Z miles per hour and consumed this much water and that much coal. It then left it to the prospective purchasers to determine if that locomotive fitted the bill. It was only later, when the need to haul more faster became present in the mind of locomotive designers and locomotive purchasers, that tractive effort started to become stated, because that was the measure of how much of a train the locomotive could get into motion. Whereas the other attributes of the locomotive counted towards how much it could haul at the desired road speed. All right, number 20, the quick guide to tractive effort, the quick reckoning is simply this. Above the line, you have the good numbers. The good numbers produce and use the steam. Boiler pressure, the measure of the potential energy captured in the steam. Cylinder bore, the measure of how much steam is admitted to the cylinder. Cylinder stroke, the freedom that that steam has to expand. Generally speaking, the longer the stroke, the more torque develops at lower speeds. The shorter the stroke, the slower the valve travel per revolution, which is best for high speed running. It's the sound of a distant train. Right, below the line we have the number that takes away from tractive effort, that is driver height. All other things being equal, a low-drivered locomotive will develop greater tractive effort, but be able to achieve a lesser road speed. A higher-drivered locomotive can achieve a higher road speed, but at the cost of a lower tractive effort. If you want to combine the two elements, high road speed with high pulling power, and the ultimate practical example of this would probably be the Union Pacific 4884 class with relatively high drivers, the way to compensate in terms of tractive effort is to uprate the boiler pressure, uprate the cylinder volume. And that's what those big end, fast running, high power locomotives did. You see the cylinder volume and you see the boiler pressure and you see the driver height. That's more an explanation of the interface between tractive effort and horsepower, which is a question for another day and potentially another video. In the meantime, that's it for Tractive Effort. Across the three episodes, you have 20 questions and answers. Hope you enjoyed them. Hope you like, subscribe, enjoy. Check back later for further content when I get around to posting it. Cheers. Have a good summer if you're having one.